Wait, can you say me if I can like may mute Discord sounds?
You have to go into your little profile thing, and right where it says like by your settings, click on the green dot and go to the red dot to do not disturb.
Okay, I see. Red dot. Okay, YouTube is live. So I believe we can start. I hope you can see everything. Okay, so I titled my presentation Unwanted Guests because I think that invasive plants and unwanted guests have a lot more in common than it may seem. And in this lecture, I will show you some basic concepts about invasive ecology of invasive plant species. I hopefully will do another lecture on more specific stuff. I mean, like talking about specific species and their adaptation, and this is more of general knowledge. Okay, so first of all, what is invasion? I have this like peak of a meadow for you, which is obviously something good. I think you can easily see that there is a lot of different species. I think you can easily spot at least five different flowers here and some trees. So what happens when we experience biological invasion? We, instead of this pretty diverse meadow, get a plot of just one species. This is obviously not a meadow, but a great example of invasion by Raunotia japonica, which is in common English Japanese knotweed. So we can see just how, I'm sorry, my rabbit is making noises. Please stop. Anyway, how there is a one giant plot of just one species. So why is it a threat? Let's take a look on a trophic chain. So this is some hypothetical situation when we have an ecosystem. The producers are plants on the meadow. We have some invertebrates, which are usually the base of an ecosystem. And then we have some mammals and birds. The owl is as a secondary consumer. So we can see that they all are enjoying themselves. They all think that the food sources are yummy, and they like it there. So what would happen if we would change the environment to just one single species of plant? Here we have this visualization as this one plot of Raunotia, and let's see what happens. As we can see, most of the animals are not so pleased. You can spot that the bee and the butterfly are kind of okay, because this is actually a species that can provide food to bees and butterflies. But this is still not good, because the only one food source is not good in general. If we ate only Pizza Hut or whatever fast food chain you can imagine, we wouldn't be healthy. And if bees eat only one type of pollen, they are not healthy either. So we have the situation when almost the major part of the ecosystem can no longer survive, because they don't have a reliable food source, while some invertebrates population may also suffer because they have less diverse sources of food. So this is one of the big threats. And to sum it up, I would like to present a clear definition of biological invasion, which is a spread of alien species, often rapid, that outcompete the native species. So the key word here is outcompete, because you may see some common weeds, and generally any weeds that, for example, you have to fight in your garden, but they are not necessarily invasive species. To be invasive, they have to be alien species. They have to come from somewhere else, and they have to outcompete and push other species out of their natural habitat. So species is invasive when it's displacing native species from their habitat, to put it in another words. Okay. So now I would like to relate a little bit to general ecology and the filing rivets hypothesis. So I didn't know what a rivet was. So here are some pics of rivets, so we all could know what we are talking about, what metaphor. So ecologists compared the ecosystem to an iron bridge that is kept together by rivets. And if one rivet fell out, the whole bridge becomes less stable. And the same thing is for ecosystems. Sorry, I need a sip of tea. So the same thing is for ecosystems. The less diverse ecosystems are more susceptible for damage. So invasive species are not threatening only local communities, but can possibly lead to collapsing of whole ecosystems by mainly by limiting the diversity of foods, because that can strongly affect the whole trophic pyramid. So how do we get alien species or invasive species in our environment? So obviously every alien species is somewhere a native species. What can happen? We can accidentally transport it in a baggage or pockets. The pockets are for me especially common. I just remember when I was working at grocery store, I would just see random pieces of sunflower seeds on the floor, never known why. So we always can by accident take some seeds with us. Accidental transport in cargo or ballast water. To be honest, ballast water is referring more to the animals, because not always plants can survive that, but cargo is a thing. Why do you do that? Stop. Cargo is a thing because, for example, a bird feed, or like in my case, rabbit feed, and in general, animal feeds can contain seeds of alien species or invasive species. This was brought to my attention by my professors, she just said to me that she feeds the birds at winter, and she just always sees that under the feeding thing, I don't know how it's called, bird feeder, whatever, they are always sprouting some invasive species. Then we have purposeful introduction as crops. Sometimes we think that it might be a good idea to just start growing a new plant. In Poland, example of this is Helianthus tuberosus, which is a type of sunflower that makes highly nutritious tubers, and it can be eaten, and it is especially healthy for people with diabetes, but it is also in Poland a weed. And then we have purposeful introduction as ornamental plant. Because invasive species can be pretty. In Poland, example of this is lupine, which in mountains is a big problem, but it does have large and vivid, colorful, just colorful flowers. So it, when the species is colonizing new areas, it it often is alien. Okay, what makes some species invasive? So the choice of ideal wheat. So it germinates in many environments, which is pretty self-explanatory. The more environments you can take, the more invasive you will be. The great longevity of a seed, because the longer seed stays alive, the greater are chances for it to germinate. Then we have rapid growth through vegetative phase to flowering. This is pretty important because weeds, as Renutra japonica, are really crazy. Like they, how fast they are growing. This is measured in centimeters per day, I believe. So this is really impressive, and such extensive growth. It takes nutrients out of soil so quickly that they basically don't leave any other for the native species. Continuous seed production, again, for me pretty self-explanatory, because the more seeds, the greater the chances for germinate and to colonize a new area. Then we have self-compatible. That means that plant can be fertilized by another flower on the same plant. And when cross-pollinated, unspecialized visitors only induced. This is also pretty pretty important, because if, for example, why orchids can't be invasive? Because orchids are example of extreme specializations. I think only like 1% of orchid flowers actually produces seeds. So they could not be invasive, because they need a very specific animal to fertilize them, pollinate them. Yes. Then we have very high seed output, again, the germination rate and the greater chances. Also tolerant and plastic, they have to be able to adapt to a different environment. Has adaptation for short distance dispersal, because this helps travel to new locations. Vigorous vegetative reproduction or regeneration from fragments. This is again a very interesting feature. I will refer again to Reinoutria because I read that even such small pieces of rhizomes as three millimeters can lead to whole new 3 meters tall plant. This is actually the tubers of Helianthus tuberosus. It is also called topinambur, but I don't know if this name is actually in English used. Then we have plant not easily drawn from the ground, because again, the extensive root system helps depleting nutrients and also helps taking up water, which is necessary for vegetative growth, especially for growth of leaves. Then we have ability to compete interspecifically by special means, choking growth allelochemicals. This is especially interesting because there is a new hypothesis, a novel weapon hypothesis. It tells us that when we have plant in a new environment, they are allelochemicals are much stronger to the native species because native species did not co-evolute with these allelochemicals, so they have a greater effect, which I find very interesting. And as you can see, we have here some leaves. This is again Reinoutria japonica. please look and take a look at their how they are placed on the stem. Then have this zigzag pattern. This actually produces limits the light that reaches the ground level so much that it actually changes the spectrum of the light so much that the photosynthesis became inefficient in the ground levels, so inefficient that when there are plots invaded by Reinutra japonica, they don't even have mosses, because it can outcompete even the mosses. So to sum it up, the plant should possess at least six of these of them traits to be considered potentially invasive. Then we also have something I didn't mention before, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to keep up with chat, but this seems not to be the best idea. The morphological and physiological adaptations are not all. Another factor is lack of pathogens and herbivores that could limit their populations. So in Poland, the case is that English oak, Quercus robur, is threatening forest. Why? Because the leaves of Quercus robur are, there are not right microbes in the soil to decompose them. They just stay there, which is really bad because they block the light that seedlings of other species need. So this is one another example of different way of invading. Yes, layer of leaves can inhibit growth of seedling of native species. So we are slowly coming to the end of my presentation, and that means that we are entering the fun fact zone. So this is actually pretty new research. I believe it is this year that in Cuba, due to fewer tourists, the number of invasive species are much less than expected. It is about as much as Puerto Rico, which is 10 times smaller. When the scientists thought that the bigger the country, the more the invasive species, because usually there would be more people there, and they would just bring more seeds. So this clearly proves that we are responsible for invasions. That obviously doesn't mean that new plants could not colonize new areas without us, but they wouldn't do so in such rapid pace. And then I have another fun fact, that cats and dogs are invasive species. This is also very new. This whole concept is only a few years old. And why it took so long to come to that conclusion? Probably because they are simply too cute. We perceive them as too cute to be a threat to our environment, when in fact both cats and dogs fulfill all the definitions needed. I hope you remember that I said that species have to be alien and species have to outcompete other species. I think that every one of us at least once heard the phrase that cats killed so much species. I can't tell you the exact numbers, I'm sorry, but we can see that their impact on the environment is bigger than we thought. This is also very interesting that invasive species doesn't have to be this scary kind of ugly species, but it can be very cute. For example, I believe that in Australia the rabbits are considered invasive species because of how much they reproduced over the time. So this is all of my presentation. Here you have sources. And I would gladly answer your questions if you have any. Thank you. I also think Fun Fact Zone is cute. I just came up with it and I really liked it. It's like kinda silly, kinda not silly. I see that in Hawaii there's a huge problem with feral cats eliminating the native bird species, I see. Also, I think this might be a bigger problem because of how isolated Hawaii is, because it is kind of isolated. Yes, Neural, they did that. But I didn't want to say the numbers because I didn't want to be wrong on record. I'm very glad, Hai, that you want more, because I really would like to do one more on specific species, and I was thinking about doing lectures about conservation biology. I think I am kind of behind your messages, because I am kind of slow readers. Yes, frogs, this is interesting. It is a very interesting question, because this is the thing, like, if invasive species have, like, can easily grow anywhere, why don't we use them? For example, the Helianthus tuberosus is actually a crop, and the tubers are sold. It is also very good as a biofuel, but in Poland it has its threatening. So the thing is, we have to maintain good levels of, like, security. We have to check if the weeds are not spreading outside the plots, the fields. And this is very hard, because many people who are farmers, they not always as precise as we would like them to be. So, answering the question, can invasive species be ever good? Yes, they can be, but using them will always come with a lot of risk. Another example is that some invasive species in Poland are actually was used as medicines. How do they predict the number of invasive species? I don't think it was based on previous years, but it was calculated, I believe, to the statistic from the whole Caribbean region. They would just kind of calculated how much they should be, and the numbers did not match. Acherontia, if I pronounce that word. Not harmful would not be referred as introduced instead, because even if they, non-harmful, maybe I understood this wrong. In Poland there is generally the word alien species, and they are some kinds of alien species, like canophytes. Canophytes were introduced after the discovery of America, and there is another word that I can remember that refers to the plant introduced before the discovery of America. So no, I didn't even ever seen the introduced instead in publication I read. Do you have a favorite invasive species? I do think that Rhinocera japonica is some kind of like cow. This is seems for me like the perfect example of the something engineered by the nature. There are numerous adaptations, but that are also other species that have some weird adaptations. But yeah, Rhinocera is definitely some one of I know the most. I think because it is the biggest problem. Like there are handbooks in Poland just about how to deal with this one weed. Mm-hmm. Yes, Mati. Please do. Yes, I was. I'm talking too much. Not really. Not a biologist. This is actually no, because invasions do not happen without people because the species could not. Like for example, I will again referred to us. To be honest, Japonica and Helianthus tuberosus, the both species are from such far away that they would not arrive in Central Europe without any help. So I wouldn't say that. Just this is something like when people said, yeah, species are going extinct, but they did go extinct before. Yes, but the speed of this process is different. This is what makes a difference. Invasive species are really something that happens rapidly. There are species that can transform a meadow in like 3 years to just one plot. Fern. I would say that I am not sure, at least I ever didn't heard about it. I would say that I didn't talk a lot about spores because spores are much more fragile. But let me check, honestly. I just wanted to see. I have a... yes, I have my like little Excel sheet with all the invasive species in Poland. Oh my God, Sailor, you did give me a little heartache that I was just talking to myself. No. Milk, not all non-invasive species are not. This is a hard thing to pronounce. Wait a second. Not all not native species are invasive. Because you can see that they would be species that have such specific demands. As I mentioned before, they, for example, need very specific pollinators that they cannot just spread so rapidly. What can I say about like non-invasive alien species? For me, it can be. I have to think about something. Wait, because I want to see about invasive ferns. Yes, there are actually invasive ferns, at least in Poland. This is Elodea canadensis. This is very invasive. Elodela natali and Lema turinifera and Lema minuta. I believe there are also invasive ferns. Yes, so there are invasive ferns. So yeah, there are, for example, the tomato. Tomato is an alien species in Europe, but it is not invasive. You don't see large plots of tomato just growing. Couldn't you use plant factory technology like in Japan to prevent spread? I don't know the term plant factory technology. So if you could elaborate on that. Yes, I mean, if the plant is in their natural habitat, they are not invasive because they have herbivores, they have pathogens, they have other species that are that did evolve with them to outcompete them. Which plant species do you found the most despicable? I'm so embarrassed. I need to translate this word. I do think that the three I will mention because I know them the best. Reinutra japonica, the English oak, Quercus robum, the Heracleum sosnowski. This is awful. This is like, it makes such strong toxins. When my professor showed me that she was researching that plant, she were full on hazmat suit, and I mean full on, head to toe. This is how bad the Heracleum sosnowski is, and it was introduced as a crop. This was one of the stupidest decisions. Are none carried by birds or dropped in poop of animals? I do think it is not far enough from their natural regions, but I never properly investigate the interaction between birds. And I think it would be especially interesting in Europe when you have birds that go to, for example, Africa to spend the winter there. What to do when a plant invasion occurred? This is a hard question because like botanists have the same problem, like what to do. They often just try to cut it because there are not better option, to be honest. Oh my god, I'm really bad at reading this question. I'm 5 minutes behind. So this is why they have to develop a special handbooks. But this is like the thing. You usually would have to just like come every year and just cut it all off and hope that someday it will just die. What are some strategies that people take to deal with invasive species after they've been introduced? So they use herbicides, the chemicals to kill the weeds. For sure, they just cut it. I know that sometimes they try to burn it, but this is not always and like most often not possible. They try to drown them from the ground, but this is depending on the species, and this is a bad question for scientists actually. Plant factories are building dedicated factories for optimal growth of given plant species, control atmosphere. I don't know how. You mean like the invasive species as crops axiomatic, yes? Because now it makes sense. And
yes, that exactly.
Okay, because I was so confused. Like, when if you have invasion, you can't just put it in a factory. I was to Kraken, like I was to. But to be honest, I'm always surprised when I see anyone from this BioCord server. You just never sound like your profile pics. And I don't even know. What? What does a full language means? Ah, sentence. Okay, that makes sense. Okay. I don't know what I wanted. Like, the thing is, I just, in a really weird way, I am sometimes thinking about things and just... Rivet and the bridge collapsing. What sort of consequences to the environment happen after the invasive species kills one species? It's never one for one. Because when you have, for example, you have like my meadow. You have like a meadow ecosystem when you have some plants that will, these fruits would be kernels. And you would have seeds as kernels that would be eaten by, I don't know, squirrels, mice, and rabbits. Then you have some plants that are good for the bees. Yes. So imagine that they all are gone. Imagine that they are now